comes to our furry family members, there are a lot of common misconceptions, some of which can actually be harmful to our animals. So today, Dr. Courtney Campbell and our animal expert Larissa are here to set the record straight and debunk some of these very popular myths, which is very important, guys. Thank you for being here.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Larissa, I'll say thank you, but you're always here.
Yeah. I never leave. I sleep here.
Thanks for being here, Larissa.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Some of the myths that we're talking about today are coming from our viewers. In fact, most of them.
Yeah.
And from new rescue parents and sometimes foster parents as well, like this guy right here.
Yes.
It's pretty common.
I get so many wonderful questions, and please keep them coming, everybody.
Yes, yeah.
I love answering our viewers. And, you know, the name of the game here is we want everybody to rescue and adopt and feel the magic that we feel with our animals.
Yes.
And so we want to debunk or get rid of anything that's going to get in the way of that. So if people have worries or concerns, especially if they're not even real, we want to help clear that up. And there are certain things I can't because I'm not a vet. So this guy is the guy to call.
Between the two of you, we're in very good hands.
We're a good team.
That's right. Let's start with the first one here. Okay, here's a good myth.
Yes.
That pregnant women should avoid cats because they will make them or their unborn baby sick.
Okay.
True or false? I feel like we should have like big true or false lines.
All right, should have sound effects as well. Well, the key word that I heard in that particular question was avoid cats. And the answer is no, you shouldn't avoid cats. Because of that really long, scary word, it's called toxoplasmosis. And it's an illness caused by a particular parasite called Toxoplasma gondii. Now, surprisingly, about a third of Americans have this parasite living inside us. It's dormant. It's not causing any illness. But it can cause illness to those who are most vulnerable immune systems, like the young, the old, and of course, yes, some pregnant women. So I say this, cats are the definitive host for this particular parasite.
Okay.
But if you're concerned about this particular parasite, here's some tips to protect yourself. Number one, make sure you wear gloves when cleaning the litter box or have somebody else clean the litter box. Also, here's something unique about this parasite. When cats shed this parasite into the litter box through bowel movements, right? It's not the cat itself, it's the bowel movements. It has to sit in that litter box for 1 to 5 days for it to become dangerous, for it to become infected.
So if
you clean the litter box twice a day, you've removed that.
Sure.
Now let's talk about the elephant in the room, which is the most common cause of toxoplasmosis: undercooked meats, soil, improperly handled vegetables. So make sure that you cook your food, don't handle raw meat, and once you're finished gardening, wash your hands, because cats are of low risk to spread toxoplasmosis.
What I hear here is this is the perfect time to have hubby quickly change the litter box many times a day.
Yes, absolutely.
That's a translation that
perfect.
A lot of people probably heard.
Yes.
Let's get to the next one right here. Great answer, by the way. I'm asking the right guy, that's for sure. Pet parents often hear that a dog with a dry nose is sick. Is that ever an indicator of illness? I definitely fall victim of this.
I think everybody is accustomed to the wet nose, right? And that's a classic for a dog. It's iconic. And if your world is ruled by smell, then having a wet nose is an advantage, right? But I will say this, I've had dogs with virulent fevers, really aggressive fevers, but you touch their nose and it's cool to the touch. Okay. Or dogs who are frigid and their nose is warm. Mm-hmm. So I think it's so important right now to not just use the nose as an indicator of illness. It could, but it's not the best thing to use. Use other things like, is my dog losing weight? Is my dog vomiting? Does he have diarrhea? And most importantly, no normals. While you're snuggling with your dog, watching Home and Family, find out and just feel around your dog, feel for any lumps or bumps, look at their gum color, feel for pulses, because if you know normals, the abnormal will jump out to you.
That's
so this is perfect.
That's a great point. By the way, that's for human health,
the
too.
The nose
absolutely
can't tell you everything.
No, it
the
can't.
The nose doesn't always know.
The nose doesn't always
know. No, I
like the summaries we're getting from Larissa here. This is awesome. Okay, I'm going to tell you one. This one sort of kind of comes from me, and it is the myth that you shouldn't give your cat milk or tuna.
Right.
I had a cat named Floyd, and I got to say, as a treat, milk and tuna was pretty common.
Right.
How badly did I treat my cat?
You're not a bad cat, Dad, because here's the reality of it. This one gets a little interesting. Because at the end of the day, cats love milk. It's delicious. And when we're younger, we all drink milk to a certain degree.
Yep.
But when we stop drinking milk, our ability to digest lactose with the lactase enzyme, it goes away. And so cats, this goes away around 5 to 6 weeks. And there are some lucky cats, just like there's some lucky humans, who can still digest milk well into adulthood. I happen to not be one of those lucky humans that can digest milk.
I'm not one of those guys either.
But because you're going to hear people people say, wait a minute, I've been giving my cat milk and ice cream for the past 10 years, and he's fine. There are some cats that can digest milk, but keep in mind, here are the risks. Diarrhea, gastrointestinal upset, and milk has a lot of fat in it, so it can cause pancreatitis. Mm-hmm. So at the end of the day, I would not give an adult cat milk. And the younger cats, find a milk replacer that is specific for kittens.
Got it.
That's the key. Mm-hmm. When you're fostering
kittens. Yeah, I have one.
You're
you know,
okay.
Granny Pants, my little foster, stepped on a bee.
Oh,
and I called the vet and they said it was safe to give her just a teeny bit of kids' Benadryl.
Right.
And I did, but I get asked a lot about giving human medication for animals, and
right.
I don't think it's usually a good idea unless right. you get the specific okay.
Mm.
So what are your thoughts on that?
Well, some people look at these medications, they say, well, if it's good for me,
right.
it would be good for my pet. And I say that is definitely not the case.
And
because
it doesn't sound logical to me. I'm glad that my logic, like, kind of, you know, red light kind of works off of that.
One huge red light, and one of the most glaring examples of this, is Tylenol in cats. We know that giving any cat Tylenol it could be fatal, right? And it more than likely will be fatal if cats are given Tylenol.
Right.
But there's other human medications that can be really dangerous. But even some of the medications that you think would be safe, like a Pepto-Bismol or an aspirin, or if your cat or dog or any pet has an underlying health condition that you weren't aware about,
right.
it can potentially cause some major illnesses. So when I think about a situation where a dog is stung by a bee, Larissa's dog, it all worked out well, but if there's a dog with a particular sensitivity, that Benadryl is not going to be on board in time.
Okay.
You know? And I even heard about one of my vet friends who had prescribed an anti-inflammatory for a dog who was limping, and she sent the dog home, and their neighbor said, hey, my dog's limping too. Why don't I take some of those medications and give it to my dog?
Mm-hmm.
And the dog hadn't been prescribed it.
Yep.
That dose was too high.
Oh, boy.
It put that dog in some trouble. So don't give your pet human medications or another pet's medication,
right.
call your vet first.
Okay.
Yeah. Dosing is key. Dosing
is fantastic.
Key. Yes.
Thank you so much. There's so much great information there. Thank you both.
Pleasure to be here, yeah.
Man, oh man, for more information, go to HallmarkChannel.com and you can keep up with Larissa, of course, at SavedByTheL.com and follow Dr. Courtney on social media at Dr. Courtney DVM. He knows what he's talking about.
Thank you.